Exodus chapter 14 opens by saying, "Tell the sons of Israel to turn back and camp before Pi-hahiroth, between Migdol and the sea. You shall camp in front of Baal-zephon, opposite it by the sea. For Pharaoh will say of the sons of Israel, they are wandering aimlessly in the land. The wilderness has shut them in. Thus I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will chase after them, and I will be honored through Pharaoh and all his army, and the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord." This portion of the Exodus narrative occurs after Moses and the Israelites have left Egypt, having set out from Succoth and camped in Etham on the edge of the wilderness, Exodus chapter 13, verse 20. The specific route that the Israelites took in leaving Egypt has been and continues to be disputed. The toponyms listed in Exodus chapter 14, verse 2 have never been definitively identified. As such, debates persist over whether these locales are in or near Egypt, or if they are somewhere much further away. In my previous video, I laid out my case for why I believe the biblical Yam Suf, commonly rendered as Red Sea, refers exclusively to the Gulf of Aqaba, the Red Sea's eastern branch along the Sinai and Arabian coasts, and should not be understood as a marshy inland lake near Egypt. By extension, I also favor the true location of Mount Sinai as being somewhere in or near ancient Midian, likely in the northwestern portion of modern Saudi Arabia. Assuming these to be the proper locations for Yam Suf and Mount Sinai, Moses and the Israelites would have been initially traveling in this direction when the command was given to him to turn back. How far along in their journey they were, we can't be absolutely sure. As much as the Bible records, though, they had encamped at a place called Etham. Like the toponyms in Exodus 14:2, we do not know where Etham is. However, Exodus 13:20 does state that Etham is, quote, on the edge of the wilderness. Of course, this begs the question, which wilderness? I realize that I have to engage in some conjecture to make my argument, so let me say now that I hold to these ideas loosely and am open to correction. That being said, I believe that the wilderness being referred to in Exodus 13:20 is the same wilderness that Israel would eventually wander in for 40 years. Given a Midianite/Arabian location for Mount Sinai, this wilderness is most likely the desert of the Arabian Peninsula. Thus, I believe that Etham was on the edge of the Sinai and Arabian border, perhaps somewhere near Edom. Keep this proposition in mind as we again examine Exodus 14:2. The word translated as turn back is the verb shuv. Most who have attempted to reconstruct the Exodus route have interpreted the command to shuv as a turn to the north or south. To properly interpret what God meant when he told Moses to shuv, it's important to understand what the consequence of this action would be. For Pharaoh will say of the sons of Israel, they are wandering aimlessly in the land. The wilderness has shut them in. Thus I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will chase after them. The reason this command was given to Moses was because it would draw out the Egyptians for their subsequent destruction in the Yam Suf. Therefore, whatever action was taken when Moses and the Israelites, quote, turned back, it was of great enough significance that it led the Egyptians to believe that, one, the Israelites were trapped in the desert, and two, they could recapture them after having let them go free. If you've watched my previous video, then you know that I am opposed to the interpretations of the Exodus narrative that have all of these events taking place locally, near Egypt's border with Sinai in a small area. However, one of the areas I have found to be insufficient are the various explanations put forth by proponents of Yam Suf as the Gulf of Aqaba slash an Arabian Mount Sinai for the turn recorded in Exodus 14:2. Most of these individuals have proposed this action as a turn off of a main road, detouring to a less traveled route that would lead them in short time to a spot on the Aqaba coast, whichever spot that may be. The reason is that shuv does not merely mean to turn left or right. It means turn around or return, the idea being an about face. In fact, shuv is frequently used to describe repentance. Repenting means turning about face from your sin and returning to an obedient lifestyle. It is not a partial or incomplete turn. With this in mind, I believe that what God commanded Moses to do was turn around and, for a time at least, begin heading back towards Egypt. The narrative of Exodus 14 should guard us from assuming that this was a full return to Egypt proper. The Israelite encampment described in verse 2 is the place where the Egyptian army, quote, overtook them in verse 9, leading the Israelites to scorn Moses before God parted the sea. Thus, the sea described in verse 2 should be equivocated with the Gulf of Aqaba. This infers that Pi-hahiroth, mouth of the canal or gorge, Migdol, tower or fortress, and Baal-zephon, lord of the north, are references to the eastern Sinai coast. However, if the turning around of the Israelites at the edge of the Sinai and Arabian deserts was enough to lead the Egyptians to believe that they were lost, trapped, and vulnerable to recapture, then this implies a time period when Egypt maintained a very strong hegemony over the Sinai Peninsula. This recognition can help in future attempts to locate the Exodus in the historical record of ancient Egypt, as we should be looking during a time when the Egyptians firmly controlled and regulated the Sinai. Furthermore, the location of any Egyptian establishments in the Sinai could be used as a clue as to where the Exodus route was. In summary, I think a strong case can be made from the biblical text that the Israelites crossed or nearly crossed the Sinai desert before camping at Etham. The command to shuv turned the Israelites around, leading them for a time in the direction of strong Egyptian territory in the Sinai, where forts, perhaps Migdols, and other military outposts would have likely been established. Given that Pharaoh had permitted them to leave, these would not probably have been an initial threat to the Israelites. Having observed these movements, though, the outposts would have sent word back to Pharaoh, who, upon hearing of this, believed that the gods of Egypt have granted him favor, and decided to recapture or kill as many of them as he can. He thus sends word to his outposts in the Delta region and Sinai to mobilize and give chase. His attempt to pursue culminates somewhere on the shore of Yam Suf, the Gulf of Aqaba, where God parts the sea and drowns the Egyptian army, thus securing Israel's freedom and fulfilling his judgment against the most powerful nation of the day. Again, I realize that there is some assumption I must embrace to propose this understanding of the sequence of events that comprise the Israelites' flight from Egypt, so I hold to this loosely, and I am open to correction if proven otherwise. In proposing this understanding of the Exodus narrative, though, if it is correct, I believe it can help us in our efforts to locate the time and places of God's work in bringing a new nation to Himself.